So I hadn't talked to you since I saw the tour date, basically, in Seattle at the Showbox. And it was so good.
No one could see anybody. Remember that?
What's that?
No one could, like, hang out. You know, it was crazy.
Yeah, I didn't even get to hang out with you. Yeah, but I mean, I saw the show. I watched it with JJ. And it was just so awesome. Like, I mean, I know all the feelings and thoughts I had connected to the years and connected to this series and everything. And then sitting back at the soundboard watching it with JJ was just awesome. So I just wanted to say thank you, you know, again, for that show. It was good. I enjoyed it. And for doing all of this has been really fun to feel this, you know, deeply into it or connected to it. And I just I wanted to get your reflections now that you've had time to be back from tour and settle and having had that experience, record out, on tour, new songs. Some of them were just incredible live and fit in, you know, so good to hear these songs in that context with those other songs, with the history, and just be back out. So before we even get into the song or, you know, and the stuff we're going to talk about today, I just wanted to give you space to, you know, reflect and process on how that tour and all that was.
Yeah. I mean, it was probably one of my favorite tours. I think a lot of it was the celebration of, like, being in a room with people again. You know, that's huge. You know, we had a few festivals, but, you know, like, this was, you know, to feel like you could tour again, it was like a huge thing, even though the tour was pretty bubbled up at the beginning and a lot of people did get sick and you know, that was tough to navigate. And but yeah, the tour and the songs, like, I mean, you know, you've known the Underoath dudes enough to know that's like, we're not the kind of band that, like, hops off stage and, like, high fives, like, yeah, dude, like, you killed it tonight, like, you know, like, great show, you know. It's a little bit more, like, chill and humble, I guess humble would be the word, and no one really gives out compliments. But I did notice that, like, you know, up front I notice everything, but, you know, I feel like I'm normally the guy, like, kind of, like, cheering the band on, like, dude, the new songs are connecting, like, they like it, you know, they like us still, that kind of thing. You know, like, I feel like I've been doing that cheerleading since, like, Lost in the Sound of Separation days, like, forward, you know, like, there's been a lot of times where I felt like I was the only one that maybe felt like things were going well, or that, you know, people wanted to see us or whatever. It was cool to see, like, how much, especially, like, Hallelujah has connected with people, to, like, to even where people like James would mention it, like, in the green room after the show, be like, hey man, like talking to the whole band, like, yo, like, you know, they sing that as loud as they sing Dangerous Business. That's pretty crazy. You know, and that little stuff, like Tim mentioning it, Aaron mentioning it, you know, everyone in the band, minus me and Chris, that are normally, like, the ones talking about that kind of stuff, you know, like, everyone else mentioning stuff like that. I want anyone that watches this to understand how crucial and important that is. This is called Hallelujah. It's like the fact that our fans are showing up and singing Hallelujah that loud goes, like, beyond anything they could ever imagine for the band's future, because it really does, like, I mean, that's so motivating, you know? Like, it's, of course, like, songs like Pneumonia, like, you're going to see a lot of this because it's that kind of song, you know, and it's like a kind of a jaw dropper and, like, a song that people use a lot. Ooh, of feelings. Yeah. It's a brutal song. It's emotional. It's a roller coaster. You're not supposed to be jumping up and down and celebrating, but the way Hallelujah comes across, and the fact that they sing it as loud as Dangerous Business, that's like two or three songs before in the set on that tour, I think was a huge motivation for the band. Obviously, we're going to keep going, and we've never not thought about keeping going. Even if people didn't care anymore, we would still make music because we've passed all this, you know, bullshit in our lives, so where we can manage to do what we love together no matter what. But I do think that that's like a huge, that's a huge thing for the band without ever even talking about it. Like, I've never even talked about this with them. I noticed, because they never talk about the crowd's reaction, especially to anything that's not off of, like, one of our first records, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's just like, it's super motivational, because I feel like, yeah, like, maybe it's always like that to me, but maybe a little bit more so now with this song and just the post-COVID thing. I think people are, you know, they're, people are happier in the crowd and the band's happier on stage and maybe notices more of the stuff that I seem to notice. Because, you know, when you're up front, when I'm not playing the guitar or the keyboard, like I'm just mic in the hand, like I am trying to, I'm connecting with people. I'm like performing to them why someone else might be, you know, like you're playing the guitar or the keys or the drums are in the back. And, you know, like you're not really as visualizing and connecting with the fans is someone like that has my role, you know? And I just, I think that the fans were that great on this tour that they, even the guys that are looking down at their guitars noticed how well that they're reacting to Hallelujah and probably some other songs, but that song was definitely talked about on the tour and we don't talk about shit like that. So that, I thought that was pretty special.
Well, that's the most fascinating thing to me in that is that I'm really kind of curious about how you think about and that post-show thing and how the personalities are, because it sounds like you're saying that of that it's meaningful that everybody sings and is connecting in that part of the show. But what really sounds like it matters to you is whether or not James made that compliment is a huge deal. Like he, you know, the fact that he acknowledged it is like really a big deal versus not.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, our band's strange. Like we can play like 3,000 people's, you know, like sold out show. And I feel like to Tim, it's like, you know, where it has been, there's like 40 people here, you know, that kind
what
of
is that. What is that? I don't think people even understand what you're saying. I do know what you mean.
You know what I mean?
I experience like, it and I've seen you guys do it, but I don't think that most people understand. I don't know. I don't actually know what it is. And I'm glad you brought it up because I just am kind of curious to explore it. You get off stage. Why isn't it high fives? Like, why isn't it like... Yeah.
I think there's like, everyone's like, dude, that was sick. Yeah, that happens a lot now more so than it did pre-breakup. Like people are like, that was rad, you know, great show, that, you know, like great crowd, you know, or they'll notice if the crowd was like, you know, Pittsburgh is a little weird, you know, or that's just an example. I don't even know if Pittsburgh was weird, but you know what I'm saying? Like, but there's not a lot of talk about it afterwards, I don't think. And I think we've always kind of like put ourselves down in a way of like, you know,
yeah,
it, you know, like when it was blowing up, it was like, no, we're not blowing up. And then when things are going well later, it's like, oh, they only care about our old stuff. And like, you know, that kind of thing. And like, oh, they're only here for the band before. So they're only here for, because it was post COVID, or they're only here because it's the reunion tour. They're only here. You know, there's always like a kind of a backwards way of saying, it's like, what if people just want to hang out and celebrate in a room and they like Underoath? Who knows? That would be.
I'm kind of torn on it because on one hand, it sounds like it's just collective negative self-talk. Like, why down talk everything? But on the other hand, maybe it's a functional thing to do in the sense that any, you know, a lot of people, if they got up on that stage and felt that actual power of people trying to connect with them and, you know, more or less worship them and knowing that it was about the music and the lyrics and all that, you know, and then. If somebody was dropped into that, you know, they can let it go to your head pretty quick. Like if you come off stage, like we're the best. Did you see that? We're the mate. Like where would that? How would that work?
Yeah, that would suck.
Adjust it to no life. Like to that would around, make sense.
Yeah, no one wants to be around people like that. Like I think we've managed. You know, I'm kind of being silly in a way. Like everyone definitely comes to the stage going that's sick. You know, that was a great show. But no, we don't really talk about like. Personally to each other, like songs or like, you know what I mean? It's always just kind of like built in, like, oh, they're going to like Boy Brush Red and writing on the walls, you know, like, and people are here and whatever. I just don't think, I think we've always been humble in a good way and maybe at times in a poisonous way of like, it's a little too negative.
You can overdo it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think we definitely used to overdo it. I think now it's like, everyone's super excited to be there. Everyone's appreciative. And on this tour, more so than any tour that I can recall, is people like Tim and James even mentioning their reaction, like crowds' reactions to the new songs.
Yeah.
Like even like, let's say like before COVID, if people were really reacting to On My Teeth, it wouldn't be spoken about, but you know, it was just like, oh, they're only here to see Writing on the Walls or whatever, you know, like that's never
feels good.
You know, it's just like one of those things where it's just like, oh, we're working, you know, like it's cool. Great crowd, you know, but I think there, it was just funny for me to realize for the first time of anyone in the band talking about maybe feeling, maybe it was like they were stoked, you know, that to see that the the fans were as excited as we were about some of the new material. You know, I think that's what you always want when you're in the studio, but you're always making the record that you want to make. And then sometimes it doesn't, I don't know. I think it's easy to read into
integrate, the incorporate. Yeah. Like you hear, I hear James, like, so it's meaningful for James to then now be putting those songs on because he was less involved in the process or whatever. So, so it's meaningful that he is acknowledging it, liking it, and becoming part of it. So now it's part of the integration of Underoath's live show, including James and broader. So that's like, that's good.
No, I mean, think about it. You know, it's like, we probably all do this, but in a way it's like, there could be 1,000 great comments. And what are you honing in on is the one guy who rips Matt Carter's guitar part apart, you know, or whatever, or like makes fun of Toby. And you're just like, yeah, mate, I didn't like that vocal part either. You know what I mean? Like that's the kind of stuff that we all do. I think athletes do it. Actors do it.
Yeah.
Musicians definitely do it. And I think we just, I don't know. We were just super proud to be playing together the way that we've been playing together. I think we're better than we've ever been in a way. And like, I don't know. I think the hard work of making our own record, self-producing it, you know, pushing each other beyond what we've ever pushed each other, and allowing ourselves to do it in a respectful enough way to where we didn't end up like, you know, 2009 Aaron quitting kind of thing of, cause he's not getting, you know, not getting along with someone, or someone says something to you in the wrong way, or, you know, me doing drugs because I don't, you know, mesh well with people, or I've got to have my own escape. Like, we did it in this healthy way of where we made a record in our most, healthiest relationships we've ever had. The band's in the best place they've ever been in a really weird time. We did that during COVID when no one knew it was going to happen. Then we get out there and finally tour, and to see people react to it. I think even the members that would normally not talk about that kind of thing, talking about it, you know, like on the bus, like, oh man, did you hear them singing Hallelujah tonight? That was crazy. You know, they were singing that louder than Boy, you know, like that kind of stuff was actually happening on the tour. And I think that stuff has happened in the past, but no one's ever said it out loud. And I think that was kind of cool. I was like, wow, you know.
Well, I'm happy to hear it. The thing's so cohesive. Like, you can tell that the production integrates with the music, with the songs, with the legacy of the band, the history, and the, you know, the visuals and stuff. And I did the episode before with Joel and Tim, and that's just building the worlds and having it cohesive and having JJ part of it. The in-houseness of the
right,
everything from the production to the live production is so cohesive, and I really, and you say they're the best you've ever been. In that is the dimension in which it really, the big payoffs, because you're great playing, had all that stuff, you know, for years and stuff, but now to really be bringing new stuff in and these really cohesive digital environment. I mean, I'm not trying to use the word metaverse, but I'm just saying the voyeurist experience is one across time and place and online and in the studio. You know, all these things are, you can feel them connected, where it used to be like there's a CD and a show, but Underoath is painted so much in between. Anyway, I found it a very powerful performance. So thank you for doing it and being out there and everything. And I wanted to get into the song today. I believe last time when we talked about how with lyrics, a lot of times you don't want to be too on the nose and stuff with it. And so that it's more people can what, but this song really strikes me, We're All Gonna Die, as like, wow, this one seems to be very direct. The lyrics feel like, I think I understand what you're saying pretty clearly. You know what I mean? Is that more the case on this one?
Yeah, this is like directly on the nose, this song, which we never do. You know, I think we did some of that. We kind of tested the waters with that a little bit on Erase Me, and probably got some backlash for it for being on the nose. But this song, this is so deliberately on the nose, and people tend to love this song.
Yeah.
And it's funny because I have a lot of different stories about this song in particular. It's like, so when I remember, I think someone at the label was like, when we turned in the demo of it, was like pumped on it and like, what a great, you know, song, super catchy. really relative to the times of like COVID, and it's like not too COVID-y, but we get it. You know, I was like, the funny thing is that chorus was written before COVID was even a thought. That was, we were actually on tour with Alice in Chains and Korn, and Tim wrote the riff to the chorus, which the riff ended up changing a couple times, but the vocal melody didn't. And me and Aaron used a hotel room. On days off, we get like two hotel rooms. If we're not spending the night, it's like shower rooms, you know? And we blocked off one of the shower rooms and brought in a Mac and a microphone and an interface. And we came up with that chorus. And well, at least the first half, the "Hey, we're all going to die. What difference does it make?" You know, that thing. And it was a placeholder lyric because it just felt good with that beat, you know, that like, it's like pushing you the whole time. Like, and it just felt really good. And we were stoked on it. We're like, yeah, well, you know, we'll work on it later. You know, like it was just like, let's get this idea out. And then we started to make the demo. And then we got, me and Aaron had that Airbnb where we demoed all the vocals out. And where we're demoing it is as we finish to get to that, to those lyrics. And that's just what kind of came out when we were working on the song. You know, like, I don't know if you've ever just like gotten up to the mic and here's the melody idea, and then you kind of spit something out, you know, and like we've got the topic of the song, we're kind of working, and then you just like, I've got this idea, and just, oh, it comes out, let's change a few words, and okay, there it is. And it felt really good. And I remember knowing that it was going to make some people uncomfortable, and that's not the point. It's just like, for the actual topic of the song, this is what we want to say, right? Mm-hmm. So that feels good in the song, it flows, but maybe we can beat it. And that's always the thing, is we're open to always beating it, you know, lyrically, melody wise, the rhythm of the screaming, whatever it is. It's like, if we can beat it, let's beat it and make it better. Like, no,
that's
one's
important. That's it. I want to flag that as an important part of the process I've, you know, learned. And I keep finding ways where the best processes, and you guys are just so deep into your theory of how your process works. It's like, that's not competitive somehow, a person versus person. It's collaborative and collective, but there's a competition in the idea space where you push, and it feels like it's almost like, in that way, it is like sports or martial arts or something, where you have to train and you have to push, and you know, it's like a difficult process where you have to things have to win, but it's not people winning, it's ideas and winning here.
Well, and I also think it's like, you know, when the initial process, I call it like kind of snowballing, you know, in the cartoons when the snowball rolls down and then it gets really big and then it like picks up Scooby-Doo and his friends and it's like flying down the mountain. Like, I feel like that's the way we work on vocals. Like, when we're snowballing this idea, like we're going back and forth, like, oh, he says something. And I'm like, oh my God, but what if we did this? And then he's like, ah, and we're going back and forth and it kind of just turns into this thing. And now we're like, oh my God, it's so rad. And then we'll demo it. And it's like, can we beat it? Can we beat it? Is it my idea, your idea? Maybe we're in the vocal booth and Tim's like, hey, what if it's "We're All Gonna Fly"? Like, obviously that's stupid, but what if that was, we heard that, we're like, that's it. You know, like that would be how we would do it. So when we demo the song, we talked about it. Like, it's so on the nose, it's kind of sick. Like, but will people get it? That it's like supposed to be on the nose and sick, like, or will the fans just rip it apart like they do? And like, we're gonna get thrown under the bus for like not having intelligent lyrics of like the dew dripping off the mystical tree,
exactly.
That kind of stuff. What we used to do, and we still do some of that more poetic stuff. But like, this song just felt like, when we started to get in there, I just didn't feel like that's what the song called for. You know, like pneumonia and does and like. You know, I'm pretty sure I have no friends, you know, like some of the songs are way more poetic than others, and not because they're weaker or someone worked on this one harder than that one. This song just felt like, maybe this is what it's supposed to be, you know? And then I remember the label talking about the COVID song. And I was like, that's crazy. Cause that the "We're All Gonna Die" stuff, like the feeling of like, you know, why are we doing this? Like, we're just gonna fucking die anyway. Like, what's the point of like stressing over all this stuff that doesn't really matter in the end, you know? Like, we're wasting so much energy on things that are not important, you know? And then COVID happened. So it seemed relative to them. And I was like, but that's also okay. Like I was like, oh, we actually wrote that before this, but that's fine because it's relative to you right now and you're listening to it. Yeah, that's cool. And then I remember, so obviously Tim and Nate from Chamberlain own King State, which is like a coffee shop, little kind of restaurant thing in Tampa. Nate being the drummer of Chamberlain, he's around a lot. And we were making the final record. And I remember going into King State and Nate was standing outside and we just started chatting. You know, he's a buddy of mine too. Like obviously Tim's closer, like they're related because they're married to sisters and they own the business together and all that. So Tim had shown him the demos. And I remember talking to Nate and that was something he immediately brought up. He was like, dude, the lyrics on We're All Gonna Die's chorus, that is the sickest thing ever. And I was like, oh, well, we're talking about changing it. And he's like, whatever you do, don't change it. It's so sick. He's like, when my band has tried to do stuff like that and it comes across cheesy and I hate it. He's like, and I know, he's like, I get it. You know, like he exactly what we're talking about. I had this conversation with Aaron in the Airbnb. Like, I wonder if people are going to get that it's supposed to be like on the nose like that. Mm-hmm. In a not cheesy way, because it sounds kind of powerful in that way to where it's like, I don't know, not trying to overcomplicate it. And like within days, I walked up and Nate, and I didn't even say anything about the song and Nate brought that up. And I thought that was interesting. And I was like, oh, cool. I mean, maybe we won't change it. I don't know, but we're going to try to beat it, you know, and it makes certain people uncomfortable. And then we had a meeting with the other two guys that don't play on the record, Grant and James, that they don't write on the records or whatever. And they had obviously had all the demos and we sat downstairs and went through each song and talked about it. And then James brought up how uncomfortable he was about those lyrics. And you said Chris, but I don't know if Chris, I think Chris said that he was like, yeah, it makes me a little bit uncomfortable, but I don't think James was more uncomfortable than Chris. And I think Tim was like, yeah, you know, like it's out there, you know? And we sat around, we talked about it and we, you know, does anyone have anything better that feels better right now? Like no one had any suggestions. We tried a couple of different things. We told them the things we had tried and we were open to trying more in the studio on the final vocal takes. And then we had this kind of conversation after the fact of like, but isn't that kind of what you want? We don't want to offend people. We're not in the business of trying to make people uncomfortable for no other reason than to make them uncomfortable. We're not Marilyn Manson in the 90s, you know, like it's not supposed to be shock.
It's not shock. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. But like, it's like, man, for the first time in our career, we're all sitting around talking about a chorus.
Yes.
How many other people are going to have this conversation?
Yes.
Like, and isn't that like, it's opening up conversations. Like our songs, we get it all the time. Like you show up at tour, this song saved my life. This song saved my life. People talk about it. The tattooed lyrics. I don't think anyone's going to get those lyrics tattooed on them, but I think the lyrical idea of this song is conversational in the way that you want it to be. It's like, now you got people talking about it. And then, isn't that what you want? It's like music's supposed to bring people together, even if they're divided on a topic of it. And now it's open line of communication, because the worst thing comes from all these songs that are about depression and heartache and drug addiction and, you know, divorces and all the things that are hard to deal with. A lot of our genre always kind of focuses on the darker stuff and the negative stuff because we don't talk about it as humans. And you know, a bunch of men in their 30s don't sit around talking about that kind of stuff. And the fact that the lyric breaks out a conversation. Yes, with, yeah. I don't think I've ever heard Grant really talk to me about what does this song mean? And we're sitting around talking, having an adult conversation about a topic. I don't know, I thought that was super special as well. So that was noted in my brain of like, maybe this is the right thing, you know? And we did still try a few other things, just like we do a cycle with the goddamn, you know, word. And it just like, it, nothing felt better. It stuck, not because it's like, let's make people uncomfortable that we're not a Christian band anymore. It just was like, man, like we've had more conversations about this chorus lyric and in the way it feels and what it means than any other song in Underoath history. Should we dull it down to not make people upset? Should, like, you know, like, I get it. James's kids are at that age to where they probably will understand, like, the stuff that I'm saying. And it's, that's, you know, there's, you know, that's a band his dad.
Did he say that? Like, my kids are going to hear this.
No, but I think he was like, you know, I don't want my kids to hear it or something. Or, yeah. Like, I don't know. You know, and that's understandable, you know?
It really is. I'm so glad to have, you know, gotten into this because I really am not a lyrics guy. I don't even hear lyrics when I hear music. I hear sounds, and eventually sometimes I've learned, I don't even listen to
lyrics. Dude, Tim is the same way. And I think this is why me and Tim have had a hard time in the past. Like, we always kind of do this because, like, I've been a guitar player my whole life, but everything I hear is melody and lyric first. Even before I was a singer in the band, I was just a guitar player in a band. Like you're the second person I've ever heard in my life say that, Tim being the other. And that is so wild. I'm glad that you said that though. That is so,
I just do not know the words to any song at all. I mean, unless I really make the effort, and I would only be after I completely understood the song in the deepest ways, but not, that's the last way. It's like the final layer. And a lot of times I never get there. Maybe if a song's simple enough, you know, I get it or whatever, but it's especially in stuff with screaming or anything like that. I mean, it's just, there's so much else to listen to. And so the fact that I'm here having the conversation with you about this song that just leaps off the page to me is because as soon as I heard one line, I'm listening for the next line, and it's still on the nose. Oh, I'm here. I'm with it. I'm following it. Because I normally don't know what the guy's talking about with the roses and the dripping. I don't. I know it's poetic. I know it's personal to him and blah, blah, whatever. Like, I just don't. Like, if I ask him about it, he'll just give me a poetic answer. If I ask Toby what this song's about, he won't even really want to talk about it or something. Because I understand it's personal to him.
Yeah, it's
and that
personal.
Makes a great song. But this is, you're telling me something and I'm hearing it and it keeps connecting. Therefore, somebody like me all of a sudden is engaged in the lyrics.
Right.
So I'm glad to hear it, Nate, you know, like the fact that it pulled Nate in, like, it feels just like Nate, like, why am I talking to Spencer about lyrics? I mean, I don't even think about that normally.
Yeah. It made me think about this conversation I had. So a lot of people probably don't know this, but well, after the reunion tour, obviously people know we went on tour with Bring Me the Horizon, and there was talks of, at one point, we were going to record our record with Jordan, who records their records, who's the keyboard player and, you know, soundscape designer, whatever you want to call it for Bring Me the Horizon. You know, like, great, great dudes. And, you know, we went out to dinner. Oh, man, I think, I don't want to misquote it because it's another band. So don't hold me to the words completely 100%. But the way I remember it, I remember sitting there in talking with Ollie about lyrics, and we were just talking about vocal stuff and lyrics. And he had mentioned something to me about the Can You Feel My Heart, that song. And it's, I think it's such a powerful song. But you know, he was talking about the lyrics. It's like, I mean, think about, like, if you read that on a piece of paper, Can You Feel My Heart? It's not like the most poetic, like, huge thing. It was a placeholder lyric that just couldn't be beat because it's just the way the music sounds and the way the vocal came out, it was perfect and it never changed. And I thought about that, and that's not 100% quotable what he said, but it was along those lines. We were talking about that song and those lyrics to that chorus, Can You Feel My Heart, you know, bah, 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 that thing. And that was, if my memory serves me correctly, that was originally a placeholder lyric that stuck because it feels so good. I mean, you listen to that song after you watch this interview and you're like, damn, it's that fucking rips, you know, it's awesome. But really think about the lyrics, Can You Feel My Heart? It's like, oh, I mean,
Like, I've got it, guys, a song. Yeah. Can you feel my heart? This is going to be a hit. And you'd be like, get out of here.
That,
yeah.
If you said that in a conversation, someone might laugh at you, you know, but when you hear it in the song, it's like, I get it. It's because of the way it's performed and the way anyone else could perform that and it wouldn't feel authentic. And it's the same thing I think with this song is the way it came out, even on the demo, it's like you're really being spoken to. Is it on the nose? Yes. Is that the purpose to shock? No. Is it a purpose to be on the nose in a way? Yes. But it's almost just like I'm yelling at you in an emotional way. It's not supposed to be, it's not like I'm trying to perform this perfectly. I'm like, wait, hang on. Let me get this little bit of the pitch and get the sentence to end perfectly so I can double and triple. It's like, it was a performance piece in a way. And I think that those are the kind of lyrics when it's,
you build around it.
And just performed, it's like, that's like saying like, hey man, I got an idea for songs. I say, hey, we're all gonna die. What difference does it make? Don't pray for me and my fucking friends. I think you're fucking fake or whatever. You know, like
nursery rhyme. It's like the darkest nursery rhyme of all time.
Yeah, it like someone would laugh at you, but when it's performed the way that it is, in the honesty of that, comes across to where it grabs people and you feel like, whoa. And I, it reminded me of that conversation that I had with Ollie and Jordan when we were talking about making Erase Me before it was Erase Me with Jordan. And obviously things didn't line up and we ended up working with someone else, but he reminded me of that conversation as well. So there's like three or four different things compartmentalizing in my brain. There's Nate, there's Chris and James talking about it. And then there's this thing from the past where I remember Ollie and me talking about lyrics and the way they can come across performed in the right way, if, like being on the nose sometimes is okay, you know? And I think this was a pure example of that, to where it was like, it was unbeatable in a way of like, we're overthinking it, trying to change it because it's awesome the way that it is. It's like, and we did a thing on that tour where we had a lot of sound checks and you could vote. And we only put one song up from the new record you could vote for on sound check. And it was We're All Gonna Die. And then we put a song from Chasing Safety and a song from Defying the Great Line. And We're All Gonna Die won a lot of times because people wanted to hear that song, you know?
It's so cool. Yeah. So the context comes from the lyric, though. Like, you had the lyric and it's there. Well, there's an idea, a feeling, and then that lyric comes from somewhere and you captured it. And now the whole downhill momentum of that snowball is adding to that feeling, so that, you know, you build around maybe what is a simple lyric or even previously would be a cheesy lyric. But if you build the appropriate context around it, which in this case is extremely brutal, but then if the package, like, then it matches. So it's a coherent idea that it sounds what that's the only way it could sound to pull off these lyrics or something. You know what I mean? It's really cool.
Yeah.
And you found the music to, and the mix and the energy and the performance to make that into what the only way it could be without being dumb or something like that.
Yeah.
Or offensive. So navigating that line, that's art. I mean, that's it. Like, how could you make this? And then that's the process.
I think it's one of those things. It's just like trusting your gut sometimes, you know, like just a lot of times your first initial like reaction to a music. You know, I'm a guitar player and I've written riffs for the band and there's been practices where I've been holding the guitar the whole time while we're writing stuff. And there's times where I'm not. And being in a position of like this song, the first time I hear the music and start thinking of melody and that gut reaction of what that is, that was like one of the first things that came out, you know? And I think sometimes you just got to trust your gut, because a lot of times that's like, you can overthink everything to death. We could still be working on Voyeurist right now if we allowed ourselves to, like, and a lot of times there's that huge fear of overthinking stuff to the point to where you suck the life out of it. And this would be a prime example of that, is if we would have reworked and reworked that chorus until everyone in the band was comfortable and the lyrics were more poetic. And then would we just have a song that's like a sleeper, you know, deep cut, whatever you call it, that just gets skipped over. At one point, this was supposed to be the single, you know, this was supposed to be the lead single instead of Hallelujah. And I think it changed. We changed the guitar. The guitar was so overbearing that we had to crank up the vocal on the verses, and it changed from the demo. because the demo stage, Hallelujah didn't change at all. We added some stuff on the bridge that made it better. We're All Gonna Die, the verses only changed because the guitars got so loud to where it felt silly. We were singing it like down an octave and it was a little more slinky. And then the chorus came up and popped and it was like, wow. And then the guitars just became so overbearing that we're like, well, let's sing it up an octave and see how that feels now that the guitars are here. And then the chorus still hits, but not like it did on the demo to where it was from here to here. And I think that kind of took it out of the single zone. But it's interesting that that's some people's favorite. I think some people on the team's favorite as well.
That's fascinating to hear your reasoning on what makes a single and stuff.
Like I don't know. That's my only guess of why it didn't. What changed? You know, because I remember that was the label's favorite song. It was the manager's favorite song. It was everyone's favorite. Like that's the. I remember getting a text from Randy in the group saying that's you guys have just written the catchiest song of your entire career. Wow. And they were talking about that song and everyone was sold on that song for such a long time. And then something changed. And I think the only thing that changed was the bringing the vocal up on the verses, both me and Aaron's parts. I want to say came up a full octave. I could find the demo.
Either way, it's cool. It's just, it's a fascinating thing. And but we had to go into the territory of, if these are on the nose lyrics, we got to spend some time with these lines then. I mean, that's almost right. Brutally uncomfortable, but that's what I find myself really wanting to do here. We could start right with the, hey, we're all going to die. What difference does it make? I think that is the on the note. That's the way you seem to anchor the lyrics. That's what the song's about, that line. And then the rest is supporting that idea.
Yeah, in a way, starting at the top, like pull me apart and scatter the pieces. My lips are moving, but I'm speechless is kind of like.
That's poetic still a little bit.
If we're doing that, like if you become dust and you're dead or you're picked apart after, I think about it a lot. I mean, not to get too deep and sad, but a lot of people around us in our age group and the bands in our, that have been around as long as us, we've lost a lot of great people. A lot of people have been over the last 5 to 10 years. I feel like we've lost a lot more people from our scene than we did when we were all in our 20s. And I feel like that puts you in a, obviously an end there to that, what that person has done musically. And then you can pick it all apart and talk about it the way that we still talk about Nirvana songs. We can sit around and talk about Kurt Cobain's work 20 years after his death and pick apart what he was thinking or saying, or, you read interviews about, he was on drugs when he was writing that. That's why. And all this, you pick it apart and everyone, they're going to say what they're going to say. So like that whole
thing.
That's
so voyeurist where you're, this is the voyeurist. It's just so integrated into that whole idea.
If you pick me apart and scatter the pieces, pull me apart and scatter the pieces and, just boom, done. Whatever I've said doesn't matter because now you're speechless. I mean, I'm being super blunt at this point, that is what it is. Like, it doesn't matter if I'm dead now, it doesn't matter anything. I can't explain anything. So you can take any song I've ever done. And that the funny thing is that people are going to make their own conclusions. They don't know me. I have got a handful of friends or close friends. And then there's acquaintances, which are all the bands you've toured with and people that you spent a month out of your whole life with or whatever it is, or a few tours. And there's the people that are really close to you. And then there's millions of people that listen to this band, have read our lyrics or watched things like this or see me on stage and made their own conclusions. And there's nothing you can do about that. Even the interviews that we've talked about 1,000 times, it keeps being misquoted as Aaron quit because I wasn't a Christian anymore and I was on drugs, which never was the reason why he left the band in the first place. And it doesn't matter what you say now, because it's been embedded in Wikipedia and AP for 15 years back in the day. Everyone made that decision that that's what it was back then. And that's still what it is. Doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter because Nothing you can say about it now. You know, like I
like
can.
It is the way it is, as it will be remembered. And you're actually the only person who knows the real truth, but you're not there anyway.
Yeah. Right. Right. Crazy. Okay. So that's kind of where we're at. You know, and in this song, it's kind of like, it's not an anti-Christian song. And to be clear with anyone that watches this, none of us are anti-Christian. I think things are great for, you know, I think everyone should be able to dive into whatever they want to dive into, read into whatever they want to read to, educate themselves and make their own decisions. And I think when you and I were a little bit younger, growing up in Christian bands and around older people, before the iPhone was in your back pocket and you could do all the research you want without going to the library and getting a book on tour, you know, like, I think we were, some of us, we followed some of those guys, you know, like we looked for guidance in some of the older men and women in our lives that were spiritual leaders or whatever it might have been. And there was a time where, not to point out any fingers, but there has been things said about me that in some of my darkest times, where it was just like, oh, just let's get him out of here. He's not really, like, we can't save him. Let's get him out of here and just put this, wow, replace him. You know, like,
yeah.
And that's where that whole, like, not good enough to be saved stuff kind of comes in. And to me, it's like, that's not a representation of Christianity. That's a representation of a human. And I remember when someone in the band asked if this is an anti-Christian song, like, what are we, an anti-Christian band? I'm like, it's about a certain circumstance because we were a Christian band, but it's not, this isn't about Jesus not being who he's supposed to be or whatever you believe in, but it's more about people. People are bad to other people. We're all have done fucked up stuff to people around us, and none of us are perfect. And that's kind of where that whole first verse is. In my experience of just being someone has literally thought was not worth it to work on when I wasn't even asking to be worked on, or, you know, like, it was just, you know, yeah, like, you'd be in that position to where it's like, let's just get him out of the way. Cause he's not, it's like, let's not even work on it. Let's just keep going this way.
Did you feel, like, that at the time? Did you know, that you were a liability, or there was external forces outside of Underoath that felt that Spencer was you know, like that?
Yeah.
That,
I mean, like, I think
a terrible place to be.
I think that was with the going home and Warped Tour and then kind of being kicked out of the band for a minute in 2006, going to that time in my life. And then it wasn't really like super hurtful at the time as much as it was later wrapping your brain around it. Cause yeah, I think it was hard to understand, you know, we were like super young and it was the beginning of a dark time for me, but I think everything happens for a reason. And I don't promote anyone going through the stuff that I've been through or taking the paths and choices that I did, but I think it definitely made me a stronger person than I am today. And like, I'm glad I went through all that shit, to be honest with you. Not because it was like, oh, the party years were fun. It's like, I mean, I'm glad I went through the hard times to be able to be where I am now. And I don't look back on it like, oh, I was treated badly or, yeah, you know,
cool.
You know, yeah. It is interesting to write about from a headspace of like a clear-headed, responsible adult to where I'm like, yeah, you know, I don't want that for my daughter. You know, I don't want her to be in a situation to where someone would ever say something like that about her, even if she was in a space that she didn't need help. You know, like, I want people to be around that are more open-minded and more loving and more nurturing than that, you know?
So you could just throw me away. I'm not good enough to be saved inside of your broken halo. There's a secret you can't keep. What a cool setup that is.
Yeah.
Like, what's about to come next with that secret? Bingo. Oh my gosh. I just love that. Like, given from that context of where you were, that is one of the coolest chorus setup lyrics of all time.
Yeah. Yeah. And these are the things that, like, I'll be sitting on a couch and like me and Aaron are literally passing around a mic. It's like one of these, you know, when we do like demo vocals that way, and we just go back and forth and it just starts going. And it's just like, that's like, oh dude, what if we, oh yeah. Like that's the perfect, you know, that's the kind of thing that's how it all goes down. It's super fun. And yeah, and obviously the chorus we've talked about, it's all on the nose. And then Aaron's lines of, let's be honest, I'm heartless, I could care less.
Well, let's start. We've really skipped over what really just hammers the hardest, yeah. I think, in the song is the "Don't pray for me and my friends. I think you're fucking fake." That, I mean, I know you've talked about that, but let's address that set directly here. I mean, that's the one where everybody's like, "Oh, I know exactly what he's talking about." At that point, because it starts kind of poetic, and then you set up a secret. And the secret's the worst. If what seems like the worst news ever, you know, and then you set the context. It's like, "Oh shit, this is us or fans." Now I'm, you know, I'm living that moment of because I've been on this side of it and that side of it. I can see what you mean.
Yeah.
So I'm just super engaged at that point.
And that comes from a couple of different headspaces of writing. Is like there was a lot of times where, you know, I had a different group of friends than the rest of the band had, and we were a little rough around the edges, and you know, we were just punk kids, you know, we were just different, you know, like, and I think that's okay. Like, to not grow up necessarily in the church and protected from the real world until you get out in your 20s. And some people keep that up and some people explode. Some people experiment, some people don't, you know, like we were a little bit more of like seeing some more real shit and some stuff around us. And we just, I had a clique of people that I felt like those dudes didn't understand, the people around me didn't understand. And it also kind of relates to, we've been ridiculed a lot. Not just, this song isn't just about the past, but we've been ridiculed a lot in the present from the Christian community. Like, I've heard a lot of things and read a lot of things about like, people are praying for us now more than ever because we're not identifying as a Christian band. And we do cussing songs and stuff like that. It's like when I got in the van for the first time at 19, 18 years old, those guys were cussing. We all, you know, it's like you stub your toe, you go, fuck, you know, or I left my wallet at the fucking gas station. Damn it. You know, like turn around, that kind of stuff. Like it's just more, you know, and like reading stuff of people's concerns about where we are as a band, but me being on the inside of the band, you know, this is also referring to like, don't pray for me, my fucking friends, as in the guys in Underoath, not because I'm like, fuck you, but in the way of like, yeah, it's supposed to be kind of on the nose and punch you in the face a little bit because I am on the inside. And the people that I've read so much stuff and talked to a lot of people that have these concerns and stuff. And I'm like, man, when we were a Christian band, we were the most unhealthy, dysfunctional group of people, treated each other poorly, treated the whole Underoath thing poorly, and it was very unhealthy. It was extremely unhealthy. And now we've lifted up this thing that allowed us to be ourselves and to communicate about things that we feel and the things that we're experimenting with in our different beliefs and non-beliefs and life and personal life and personal demons and all this stuff. And post-breakup, the band has the healthiest it's ever been. And there's guys in the band that are atheists, you know, like Grant is openly an atheist, but he's in such a better place than he was when he was a Christian. And I'm not saying that Christianity is wrong and this is an anti-Christian song, but for our band and what we were going through and all the pressure that was put on us and the way we pressured each other and the way we didn't communicate and the way it was supposed to be, and it just implied that you had to be away, it just put up all these walls that was, you know, as your brain is developing, as you're in your late teens, going into your 20s, and you're supposed to be developing these social skills and these just skills in life, like was so stunted by all of this crap, you know, like, and it was just super unhealthy for a long time. And I just think that it's no place for people to say that about us when they don't know us. And that's really where that second context of that comes from me, as a kind of an uppercut in a way.
Oh, wow. So, you know, what do you mean when you say, I think you're fucking fake? Like what are you saying to who then? Kid, this is kids praying, wanting to pray for you after shows. And you're looking at them saying, I think you're fucking fake. Is that, am I getting that right?
I mean, not necessarily the people in the crowd, just the idea of like your reasoning behind it, the self-righteous person that, you know, like we've had in our lives, and that, you know, there's different people that we've been around that aren't Underoath fans. We're talking about elder people, you know. You know that it's just a weird thing to say to someone like that doesn't know this or spent the time to ask or really care. You know, that self-righteousness of like, I'm going to pray for you and for you guys to come back to Jesus. I'm going to pray for you guys when you don't know. You didn't even spend the time to talk to us about who we are or where we're at. Like, you know, I'm only even like, you're making up a conclusion based off of the idea that we aren't a Christian band anymore, you know, like, so we're clearly lost. We're clearly in a worse place than we were before. We're clearly like, we need help, when it's absolutely the opposite. We've never been healthier or happier or gotten along better in our personal lives and in our life as a band. So it's kind of, you know, it's not coming to the fan that's saying, oh, I'm praying for you guys. Not like in the like way of like praying for you guys out there to stay safe. Like, it's more of the person who's implying that we need help, you know, to come back to what we were before in the past. And in the past, we were a big fucking mess. You know, like, we weren't on paper is like what you looked up to, because we were a healthy young Christian band doing all the right things, but we were a wreck. Now we're not a Christian band, but we are way better people. All of us, everyone. And some of the guys are still Christians, but they've learned a lot about how to treat others and treat themselves. And, you know, any one of the guys I would trust with my own child. And in the past, I would not say that, you know.
Wow. So let's be honest. I'm heartless. I could care less. You know, that's the, how's that one?
That's like the how you perceive me.
Thing. Yeah.
You know, like that's, and it was a great, great line.
You're playing the character they want you to be.
Yeah, you know, and it's the great line that for Aaron to sing, and the way he sang it, it's so perfect for him too, because he gets a lot of shit as well as I do. But I feel like for him to sing that line is so much more powerful than if I sang it, because of the slack he gets, because he did do a lot of work outside of Underoath, and you know, it is a lot harder for him because he did make a worship record and all this stuff, and you know, went to different churches and prayed for people and did all this stuff. And in the backlash that he gets about this stuff is that to me,
that's
you know, is that like, oh, he could care less. It's just about the money, or it's just about this, or it's just, and the way that he sings it is like, he's not really heartless and he does care, but the way he sings it, it's supposed to be like, that's another of those conversations. Like, are people going to get it? Like, are people going to understand? And when it's done the right way, I think they do. And it's honest. And we actually we thought about it. We didn't just throw some words out there. And I think the way that he sings it and the way that comes across is just so perfect.
Yeah. And the whole thing, you said the word conversational earlier, and I'm just feeling like by this point when I'm gripped in there, this song is really a conversation between you and somebody in a place and time. Like, that's what just so clued me in, draws me into. It's like, this is conversation. You say, you're not alive. You know, you don't pretend to be alive. You're not alive after they've said this to you. And so it's just really, really clear.
It has so many different meanings of the way it could come across too. Is like, you're not alive. Like, is that whole thing is like what we were trying to talk about earlier. It's like, it doesn't really matter what I say, cause you're not listening. Like, you're not really wanting to know what's really going on, or are we really doing good? Like, you're not hearing it just because you've fixated on what you want to fixate on, which is the one thing you read about us not being a Christian band. So your mind is already made up. So we're not even like, it doesn't matter. We could be dead. Like, at that point, it's like, we're an afterthought that you're just talking about, and the way that you, in the context that you want to say it. And I think we all do that with everybody, you know, like, think about the way people talk about actors and actresses and people on TV. And like, I mean, silly enough, like think about like the Kardashians, you know, the people with all the money that people love to hate on. It's like, yeah, we love to hate on it because the way it's portrayed on TV and the way it's like, but we don't really know how those people are. I guess you do from the TV show, but is that real? I don't know. That's how it's portrayed. But like, if unless you really know them, like, is it safe to say it's like, all those people are this or that, you know? And it, you know, that's just an example. And like what I was saying about the Kurt Cobain thing earlier is like, we sit around and dissect the guy's lyrics. He doesn't have a voice anymore to talk about them. And we've, people have written articles and books and all this stuff about it. And it's just, yeah, it's a weird thing.
We don't have to go through literally every single lyric or, if, as long as you're being on the nose and saying the answers to things, that, you know, tell us some stuff about you, and all of this puts more context to Spencer that you allow, that's, you know, authentic and vulnerable, which is why I think it works. But now you're saying, is this heaven? Is this hell? What's the difference? I can't tell, you know. I am curious about that one.
The whole, like, you don't need to teach me to breathe thing. Like, it's like, I remember at different times in life where it's like, what if we did let people be different from us? Like, because you don't do it the same way that I do it doesn't necessarily mean it's wrong. Let's think about it as songwriting. Let's think, you know, like there's a million ways to write a song. You could start with a guitar. Someone could start with a bass. Someone could start with a piano. Someone could start with a lyric. Someone could go backwards. You know, it's like that happens a lot with different religious groups, I feel like, because you have to be a certain way. And if someone's not doing it the way that you think that they should be doing it, if you feel like you need to tell them how to do things. And I just think that's what's wrong with organized religion. Maybe like it's like not letting people get to their own finish line. Uh-huh. You know,
that like, might be a bit problem in more than just organized religion, but just organizations, themselves. Yeah. Like they all have limited, they're all limited individually, but they have their norms that the people in them, and the religion one is particularly, I guess, in the realm of morals, which is even particularly annoying.
Yeah. Yeah. So where you were at was, is this heaven? Is this hell? What's the difference? I can't tell. I mean, it's just life, isn't it? You know, like you could flip the coin on either side of like what you're focusing on, you know, like what are you can look at this, I don't know, this video and find a million things wrong with it. The things that we've said, we could point out, you know, the times that we didn't know exactly what we were saying before we said it, or you could take the good from it and focus on that. You know, I think there's so many different ways to look at what you're going through. Is it the hard time and you're going to sit around and talk and focus on how hard it is and how much it sucks? Or is it the time that you realize that you're working harder than ever because you're going through something and you're looking at all this stuff? It's like, okay, I don't know how to explain this. Like, let's say you're overweight and you're trying to work to get here. You used to be here. So are we going to sit around and look like, oh, I don't look like that anymore. I look like shit. I'm just tired. I'm like older and just blah, blah, blah. Or is it the guy who's like, here's my goal, and I'm going to work really hard and I'm focused on all these things, even though when he looks back on it, he was down here, you know, it was at the bottom. He was rock bottom. But when normally you're at rock bottom, you're not sitting around going, oh, I'm at rock bottom. This sucks. This is, you know, this is sometimes there's really bad rock bottoms. You're focused on all the good shit. So you're actually working really hard and you're doing way better than the results show. Yet, you know, and then when you get to the mountain that you've climbed and you look back and you're like, oh man, I was at rock bottom. You know, that was hell back then. But it's like, but did you remember it as hell when you were in it? Or was it some of the best times of your life because you were working super hard to get somewhere? You knew what you wanted and you went for it. I don't know. I don't remember exactly where we were going. We wrote that line, but that's in hindsight of where I kind of pull from it is like, even the dark times are some of the best because you're going somewhere, you're leaving, you know.
Interesting. So I mean, you really are pulling us in. I mean, you know, those are concepts and lyrics and things like that, but they are, it's like you're saying that heaven and hell are here, both, depending on your point of view. Like, I mean, the suffering is like, you know, I'm asking you actually as Spencer, like your concept of hell is, what do you do with those two concepts spiritually?
Yeah.
Like, how poetic is that? Or is that how you see hell is real? It is here, having a negative point of view. Is that what hell is?
I mean, as far as we know, you know, right now, like I think that heaven or hell of the context I'm speaking of is not actual spiritual heaven or hell, uh-huh. like afterlife. It's just where you're at. Like, this could be hell every day, or this could be great. You know, like you can make it what you want, no matter where you're at in your life. Like all the shit around you, all of this negativity could be all you focus on. Or you could see through the noise and you're focused on all the good shit that's happening, and you know where you're going, because you know yourself better than whoever is in your life that's putting you through this or making you go through these steps or these things, I guess.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's cool. I mean, you know, it's similar to something else you said earlier, that's just focusing more on your own experience is as being, now I don't even know how to say what you're saying, but you're making me have interesting thoughts that I'm not even able to connect. So anyway, I really appreciate going through it. What else is here in the lyrics that you want? I mean, that's deep for me.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like, you know, the song could even be like thought about as an argument that you're having with one person or with, you know, like this song can be pulled from so many ways, which is why I think makes it special, is that you can explain it to someone, and I think it could have different meanings to different people, even though it's not like a super poetic song, it's on the nose, you know. And I think everyone has kind of felt this way, even if it's not a religious thing, you know.
Yeah.
But it's not an anti-Christian song. It's more of a anti, you know, righteous person living. You know, living human being, an equal, you know, because we're all equals in that way. And like, I've always thought about that, you know, like what gives someone the right to go tell someone else how to live or what they should be doing? Like, you see the people like giving advice when they don't know someone or haven't taken the time to learn about someone because they're at a good spot of that particular day or that particular week or that particular decade, you know, like. I think when it's honest advice and honest help, that's great. But when it's the self-righteous, like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing because I'm a leader of some sort, you know, like, I don't know. I don't really think that's necessary, you know, unless you're like, you really spent time with this person. Like I went, like we were saying, like the real people in your life that you're actually, you know, your friends that you know and actually talk to about stuff, you know, I don't know. I think about that a lot with, you know, and this song kind of hits on that in a way of like, even like us outside a show, like giving advice to some guy that we don't know. We haven't taken the time to know him, you know? Is that really our place to do that as human beings? Like, I don't know. I think if it's honest advice, like the self-righteous thing, I've seen it, I guess, and that's kind of going back to the religious thing, but you've seen it a lot of those Christian festival type things, is people doing that.
The last thing I want to know about this is the performance or the capture of this. What do you remember about actually, you know, getting these takes or whatever?
It was pretty easy. I feel like the songs like this that are like, I think the intimate songs that are like pneumonia, when we get on and talk about that, I'll talk about the like tracking the vocals for that would be completely different than this. And tracking the vocals for I'm pretty sure My Luck and Having Friends was different than this. These kind of natural for a heavy band, you know, like when I track vocals for my other project or for other people that I'm like writing for and like different genres, vocal takes a lot of times are different than Underoath. Underoath vocal takes a lot of times especially for a song like this, it's just performance based, and it's like, was the timing good? There it is. You know, like that. It's not hard to do those types of takes because it is an emotional thing. It's like just get in the headspace. You're looking at the lyrics. You're about to record. And, you know, you just take some time and just like kind of feel some of these feelings. And just there's something about it. It's like when you're writing music, certain songs pull at me with a certain emotion. Like I was listening to something today that just like made me feel like in a really dark place, and I'm in a great place, but the way this music sounded, I was like, oh, I just want to write in this direction because I just feel it from the chords and just the atmosphere of it. And this song has that, like, this is like a fucking, a little bit of like a, no, fuck you. Like, you don't know me. Like, this is an argument kind of like a, and you just, and I was just thinking about all the shit that I went through, and it's just like, boom, it was like a take or two. It was like, it was easy to track a song like this because it's just an honest vocal take. And a lot of times some of the poetic stuff or the intimate stuff, you know, you got to get in that headspace, which is different for Underoath, because Underoath's got so much energy and so much like all the time. There's so many cooks in the kitchen, and to get in that, like, you know, and we'll talk about that in the, when we talk next time, but, it's different than any other band I ever tracked vocals for. I remember, it's like I went and did my solo record that's opposite of this. And I remember JJ hearing it and just like, dude, why don't you ever do that than Underoath? I'm just like, it's just a different thing. It's just a completely different thing. Underoath is, it's got so much weird energy around it, and it's got so much, I don't know, I feel like we're always proving ourselves to each other and ourselves. And it's just like, it's this thing that, that requires all this extra energy. That's just, I don't know. I don't act like
somehow
that.
It makes it easy. The concept that comes to me there is like alignment. I'm here. It's like, if everything's aligned, your headspace.
Yeah. And sometimes
if everything's aligned,
more,
it's easier. It just is what it is.
And sometimes it's way more difficult than it would be with anybody else because it's us, because we've done this along with each other. You know, like sometimes it's like, this would be easy just to do it anywhere that's not with you guys, you know, because there's so much energy and pressure and stuff with Underoath. It's like, I think we're all ready to jump on each other and at any time or suggest things. And there's all these but I think that's just because everyone really cares. You know, I think
it's the temperature, that competition that just is always sticks. You could call it the temperature. You know, the pressure and temperature go together in the machine that it is. And it's like, you guys have run it so hot so many times, you know, and now you've learned how to bring it just down to control that high temperature thing. But it's like this competitive driven.
It's not even really
something.
It's not the competition necessarily. It's the, like, we all care so much. And that's what makes
intensity.
It's because it's not for any other reason that you want it to be the best too. And so do I. And we're all excited and we're all eager to share our idea on it or our take on it. And none of us are right because none of us are also wrong. So it's, where do we get there? And there's so much. And I think that's why recording with Underoath sometimes is really easy. Like for a song, like a chorus like this. And sometimes it's really hard for something that can be simple. Like I can record it right here, right now in 5 seconds. It would be beautiful. But in this room, when there's this, and we're all, we want it to be this. And it's like, there's just this energy in Underoath. It's like, I can't explain it because I've never felt that with anyone else, the good ways of it and the bad things of it, working with anyone. And I've worked with so many other artists and other people and been in so many different weird scenarios and weird studios and like lots of pressure, like walking into a studio where this guy did, what did I walk into someone that did, what's Harry Styles been? Oh, One Direction was there like 3 days before I walked in there. And I'm not fucking Harry Styles. I'm going to walk in here and just sing. What's the worst that's going to happen? He's going to make fun of me when I leave, or he's going to think I was awesome. You know, there's two ways that this can go, and feeling that pressure in a different way is just totally different than the Underoath thing. It's like, I think we all just want all of us to be stoked, and it's fuel. And it's also like, I don't know, there's good and bad to it. And it's no way to explain it without someone being an Underoath, I guess.
I think you do a great job at painting the picture. And, you know, I really think it's cool. It's like, but it's there's a balance that is that you're at now that everybody keeps referencing. But, you know, anyway, it's cool to hear the mechanics of it as best as you can describe.
And I've been in plenty of situations that it should have been harder than what Underoath is, but it's not. It's just easy. And then sometimes, like, things like this with Underoath are super hard because we all do care so much. We're all so attached to it. When other times it's super easy in a scenario like this where it's like, this is what you fucking do. You just get in there and do it, you know? So this was one of those songs.
Well, thank you for, you know, doing the work on this song. And now that it's shared and it's out and part of the, you know, it's out in there in the voyeurist land and the digital world. And this is one of those songs where there's going to be videos of you singing it where your lips will be moving, but you know, after you're gone and people will be seeing them and doing, in fact, this podcast is that, like, your lips are moving here. Somebody be watching this podcast at some point when we're not here, maybe that could happen. Right. And then in which case, what a weird moment you're having right now. If you're listening after Spencer and I are both dead.
I also, like, I want this song. I want to play this song live. So I'd be interested if people want to hear this one live.
I would love to. I think it would go over really well. Just works so well.
I wish it was, the plant was watered a little bit more from the label team and management side, because if this song would have been, had a video for it, like some of the others or whatever, you know, if it had a little star beside it on Apple Music or whatever it was, it's like, this would be such a cool song to see. There's something about it. It moves in a way. And I feel like if this was a song that wasn't a song you had to listen to the whole record to hear, because it wasn't really pushed solo, This song could have just moved an audience. I think I could see it at festival. I don't know. I think about live a lot. I'm just like, man, this would have been a great one to like put on the forefront of the record of like, this is a song you need to listen to, you know, because some people do that. They only go through and look at for what the popular songs are and listen to those. And this one would have been a great like festival.
Still can be. That's just my vote. Add my vote to yours and see if you can prioritize it in a future set list.
Well, get the comment section going if people want to hear it live or not. I mean,
that'll let them know. If you let them know it up
at the... Let them know. I can see it like just starting a festival with that snare crack. Just...